Okay, I think we've probably got everybody we're going to have for such short notice. Let me just do a final check. Okay, we'll just do a check. Don't matter if you've got no microphone, that's fine. As long as you can hear me, awesome. Okay, right. Thank you for this very late starting one. I've just got literally this moment in the last 10 minutes got back from a Wassail. So I've got had a little bit too much to drink. So not sure how this is going to go. This could be quite fun. Or not. So for the benefits of you in Second Life, I'll give you the quick rundown, because this is a dual transmission. I'm working with you guys on Second Life, as I usually do, but also I'm recording this for video for my YouTube channel. So, those that are watching on YouTube, if I don't look directly at the camera, it's because I'm looking at the screen down here, where the action's happening. And for you guys on Second Life, if there's any weird talk, that's because I'm talking to the camera and telling everybody what's going on. So, I'm having 3 or 4 conversations simultaneously, and that's how we go. So, I see a few new people here. So, welcome to this session. I sort of call it sort of myth, magic and stuff, because it worked really well a couple of weeks ago, and I thought I'll just run it again because I really enjoyed it. And considering, as I've said, I've just come back from a Wassail, and for those of you who do not know what a Wassail is, it's actually quite late in the year for the Wassail. Normally it's sort of 12th nighty kind of thing, first week of January, where it's the waking of the apple trees to produce a good harvest. Well, our local one is their first one this year, and I went along to support them, and they did a fantastic job. It was great. We certainly woke up a beautiful apple tree at the pub. Also, I imbued a fair number of pints of really good beer. And, oh, hey Joy, I'll just keep going, hopefully you'll catch up with this. So the Wassail is about waking things, so there tends to be a lot of alcohol, cider, beer. That's okay, no worries, I'm only just explaining where I've been all day. And again, you know, this sort of fulfills the sort of the theme of this particular session on myth, magic and whatever, because tradition is a really good thing. And in this part of the country, in Southeast England, we've sort of been not quite, we've sort of lost much of our tradition. There's been a lot of groups that have been furthering and trying to reawaken it. And, you know, Southwest have quite a strong, the Cornish and Somerset culture and way of life has been quite strong. But Kent, where I am, it's, you know, it's known as the Garden of England. It's where people just walk up the garden path all the way to London via the motorway, and they don't bother stopping for the rest of it. Voice. Okay, let me just fill this in. Okay, hopefully, right, as long as you can hear me. Okay, we it's the way of the joys of Second Life. Okay. We have problems for some person. Good old Joy, my bud. Anyway, I'll better mention that I'm doing a dual recording. Okay, right. That should help. Anyway, so with the Wassail, there's a lot of. Let's just do a quick. I know two of you. The rest of you, whereabouts on this planet do you happen to be? I know where Demora is. And I know where Joy comes from. So, okay, middle of the US. And. Okay. And the US, okay. Right, okay. So some of this probably has no bearing on the kind of stuff you're familiar with. Yeah. I've got a vague idea of where you're talking about. So we have in the UK, and I'll talk about the UK because, that's where I am. Southwest UK is a very, it's certainly got a lot of tradition. The Southeast, where I am, we are, sort of London is sort of taken over much of the cultural aspect of the Southeast. Yet, we do actually have quite a lot of ancient lore, but it has pretty much been forgotten over the time. And mainly because, people move around and things get lost. I know we've got a few sort of scattered stone barrows. I was going to say burrow, but that's not Harry Potter. You see, I've had a bit of a drink, so things are going to get a little bit weird. I mean a barrow. As in burial places. So we've got a few of those scattered around the county. Mostly, of course, it's a fairly, I was going to say arable, but no, it's quite a lot of farmland. So, agricultural, that's the word I was looking for. So, our county has been really intensively farmed. In the sort of, I don't know, our Celtic period, bronze, not Bronze Age, but Dark Ages. This county was pretty much all forest, and so there was a lot, a completely different landscape to it is now. Now it tends to be all fields and so on, and we've lost a lot of the cultural stuff that possibly went on. There's a county sort of animal, the horse that the Romans called Invicta, and that sort of has taken a resurgence the last, I don't know, maybe 20 years or so. We've got a radio station called Invicta FM, and there's lots of companies making use of the Invicta signal, and there's even a white horse at Folkestone, the Invicta White Horse. I think it was, now this is not really my area because I'm more of a comedist. Cometic practitioner rather than any sort of the local in Celtic kind of stuff. But Epona, the horse goddess, I think. Is it a goddess? I got no idea. It's not my thing. But that's sort of the main feel for main animal for this area. So there's a old sort of tradition. Now, across the UK in particular, there's this Morris dancing, and I'm not sure if you guys in the US are familiar with what a Morris dance is. It's a folk kind of, how do you explain Morris dance to someone who should I even explain Morris dancing? It's a bit odd if you're not familiar with it, and there's different types of Morris dancing. It's a folk dance, sort of fertility dance. it's quite common during Beltane, where most of the morris dancing tends to be. And in Kent, we tend to have the Rochester Sweeps Festival, which is loads of morris troupes. They are just all weekend, 3 days of just stuff in the high street. And then just outside the county, down at Hastings, is the Jack in the Green, which is another great morris event. So, but, you know, morris dancing is more of a countrywide thing. To Kent, and again, this is all fairly new to me, because I'm not sort of I am native to Kent. I was born here, I was born in this town where I live now, although I was born at the hospital here and I lived for most of my life in the nearby town, about 8 miles north of here along the coast called Deal, and I'm now in Dover. As in, for you in the US, the White Cliffs of Dover, that famous place, that's where I am. And let's think, looking out the window, oh actually it's quite foggy so I can't just look out the window and see the Dover Castle at the top of the hill. But, you know, which is, usually I throw some photos on people shared with me on Facebook, on Second Life, and they go, wow, massive castle, yeah, that's one at the top of the hill, it's lovely. Anyway, where was I going? Oh yes, I'm not native to, well, I was born here, my sister was born here, my mum was born in Kent, but, you know, my family's on both sides are from out of the county, sort of Portsmouth, London, and my dad's side's Bristol. So I don't really have the roots I have in Kent from you know, my parents when they settled here, my parents' family that settled here and sorted, got into whatever it is. It was the local coal mining at Betsanger, couple of miles north of Deal, Betsanger Colliery, where there were miners. So my sort of connection with the local folklore is quite a recent thing, and I really regret that. And I was having this discussion actually at the pub when we were doing the Wassail. And I don't know about many of you guys where you are about what kind of folk traditions you have locally. Now, you know, traditions don't necessarily have to go back a long way. For example, what we were doing today was a new tradition. Now, a new but an old tradition. Our Wassail, which tends to be mostly associated with the West Country, where most of the sort of cider and apple trees were, Kent has used to, not so much now because agriculture's changed a lot, but it used to be obviously called the Garden of England. We used to have a lot of orchards, more than we do now. Lots of apple trees, cherry, cob nuts we were famous for. Luckily I have a cob nut tree in my garden, which, and I don't have the bag of cob nuts, hazelnuts, they are, they're downstairs because they are really yummy. Hazelnuts are just wonderful. So we had a lot of traditions over centuries, and one of the traditions which we brought back over this past, I don't know, few months, not necessarily me, when I say we, there's a local group called Dover Tales who've been doing a lot of folk stuff around the area and replaying a lot of the tales and folk traditions of East Kent in particular. Now, Kent's a little bit of a odd place because there's a split, West Kent and East Kent. East Kent is where I'm in. That's sort of on the edge of Dover. It's sort of East Kent vertical. And particularly, there's a style of folklore or folk plays, Something called Mummer's Play, where it's a tradition of oral tradition of passing stories from one generation to the other, and it's a reenactment. Now, we had one called Hoodners, and it involves a wooden horse, and it was very entertaining. And I'd heard of this, you know, it's a old tradition, but I've never really seen it enacted until today, after all these years, because it's not massively common, and it's something I do feel that I've missed out on over the years. You know, folk music has sort of come in, and you know, it's when you're a teenager in particular, you know, folk music, oh, that's just something you really don't want to get involved with. You know, it's not cool and trendy. But actually, I wished I had. I remember, and again, this was the conversation I had at the pub, was about when I was growing up, my mum's side, her dad was from London and was a proper Cockney, born under Beau Bowles, and he was proper. And most of my childhood was memories of being in... someone's just asking for a teleport to the thingy. Okay, right. So I had, let's just say hello. Right, yes, so most of my childhood memory is of lots of music and partying. And I was possibly, by this time, I was supposed to be about 10, 11. But I think I was probably too young to really feel value from it. Okay, I think... okay, so I feel I lost out on that. Okay, I think someone's got the wrong... Okay, I think someone's got the wrong TP. Never mind. the wrong just been invited to the wrong party. Never mind. I'm sure she'll disappear. Rhiannon, I think you might have asked for the wrong part. I saw a TP request, I gave it. I think you went to the wrong place, but never mind. I think you're after a different talk, not mine. But you're welcome to stay. okay, so... where were we? Hoodners. So, you know, there's all these traditions, and I think wherever you are, you know, you're going to have a tradition that's... Oh yes, this was it. Now, the Hoodners play that we've just done today, and I say we, it wasn't me, it was another group who were doing it. I was just there to give enthusiastic support. But that play has, and tradition, sort of died off for 100 or so years, and now we are starting it again. So the tradition is a new tradition to actively perform every time, every year, and we'll start it again and revive it. All these things do come in cycles, and no matter where you are, if you have a tradition that is new, then go for it, enjoy it, do what you need to do. Traditions have to start sometime, and it doesn't matter if they're ancient or new. It's very important that you engage and get a community behind you. Like, I went to the pub, and I had no idea who most of these people were. And then I started chatting with them, and, you know, sharing thoughts, and, you know, I had a couple of pieces of wood, which I've left downstairs. But, you know, we were talking about what they were, and, you know, one of them was a handle for the sistrum that I was making. And I showed them pictures of the sistrum, and we got talking, and we shared ideas and thoughts and so on. And, you know, it helps. This is the whole point of sort of these kind of experiences. Murmurs plays and this oral tradition that we sort of lost over the last, I don't know, 100, 200 years, maybe 300 years in some cases. This tradition of sharing our experiences and knowledge needs to come back. You know, we got the wonders of the internet, and we have these kind of things, you know, YouTube and whatever, email and Facebook and so on, and we share ideas, but, you know, they're very superficial a lot of the time. Now, I'm lucky enough to go to festivals, and I know, and I'm happy to see, you know, Demora and Joy at Witchfest last year, and there's other events we'll, you know, cross paths at. And some of you guys in the US, you know, you possibly have events going on. When you get that community together, it may not necessarily be a local community where, you know, the ideas and conversation will continue continuously day after day for year after year. But, you know, these festivals, I have friends that I only see once or twice a year at these festivals. And it's really important to feel a part of a community. And, you know, in some cases, that's the only outlet most of us have, is at these events. Whereas in our community around us, where we live, you know, it's quite common to feel disconnected and so on, because, you know, we all share different lives, experiences. You know, if it's a big place, then, you know, there may not be many people we see on a daily routine. You know, I have the street out here, and there's two or three neighbours that I see and say hello to. But, you know, we all lead such busy lives now that the connection with our local community in many places has sort of really been heavily eroded. I remember when I lived at home back in Deal, when I grew up, we lived in a cul-de-sac, and we were always in each other's houses, and it was great in some extent. You know, I had lots of friends, and we used to play and go across the fields and explore, and that in itself is a very binding thing, a cohesive group of that you feel a part of, even though it's a small kind of community, because it was just us. You do feel a part of a pack, and that's a very important thing, and that's what these traditions and folklore that's around us provides. We find a common theme, such as the play that was enacted today, which was a reenactment of. Actually, I can't even remember. You see, I've had that much. I wouldn't say I've had that much to, that much to drink, but it was quite entertaining. And I've, you know, that was a few hours ago now. Things have moved on. And but even so, it was very foggy out there. It's sort of very cold and foggy. So I've got a bit of a cough back. But, you know, we all sort of, the information that was transmitted through that play was entertaining, and it was a parody, and of local events, and they tuned it beautifully to the area. And you know, this is another thing as well. Sort of in the UK in particular, and this probably does not translate outside of the UK at all, is something called pantomime. And that is a role reversal kind of thing. And it's a very tongue-in-cheek kind of stage experience, theatre, where boys dress as women and women dress as men. And, you know, it's sort of designed, is a very similar to a Mermers play. I think it's where the tradition has certainly continued on. It's generally very entertaining. The classic ones of Peter Pan, well, I wouldn't say Peter Pan's a classic pantomime. But like all the Hans Christian Andersen stuff and all the fairy tales are usually reenacted as pantomime of Cinderella and let's think what else have we had recently. Jack and the Beanstalk. But they're very entertaining on many levels. They communicate with their audience. For the children, they have children sort of jokes and comedy that matches those, and for the adults there's stuff that floats well above the children's understanding. It's a very unusual experience, and those of you who are in the US, have a nose on the internet and look for pantomime. It is quite an experience, and it does echo back through our particular theatrical heritage. Where are we going? Oh, okay. Well, that's just me on Wassailing. So, where shall we go now? Anyone got anything they want to throw? And of course, you know, the usual intro that I normally give, you know, we're well over halfway through. I better give it, just so that, you know, familiar. So, hello. I'm Kia, on Second Life, and I'm Kevin, real life. So, you know, if anyone here, obviously you lot in Facebook, YouTube land who are watching this, you're not going to get this. Those of you here in Second Life, if you've got any questions at any time, and wondering what the hell I'm going on about, I'm happy to just to answer any questions as we go, especially because the Second Life voice can clip out and there can be drops and you just don't know what the hell I'm on about and it leaves half the sentence behind, which is another reason why I keep talking, because I see the little green dot flashing, then I know it's transmitting. If I stop, I don't know whether it's going to clip out the start and end of a sentence, so I'll just keep going. So you're welcome wherever you are, you know, here Second Life or YouTube. Those of you here in Second Life who aren't aware, that's my website. I'm not sure if I've got a link there to my face. Oh yeah, top right corner, Second Life notice, PDFs. There's a link there to previous sessions on Second Life and to the YouTube channel. I really need to do something better than that. But anyway, so this is where this will possibly appear at some point. I'm not sure if this is going to go up yet, because I've had a few and I'm not sure how stable this is. But hey, I'm enjoying it, so it probably will. Let's see, where shall we go next? Oh yes, I know. On Thursday, I was doing a real-life workshop on spellcraft. And that's always quite entertaining, because it's something I'm currently writing about for the next book. So it's something we can have a nose at now. Unless, of course, anybody down there feels they want to go elsewhere. Oh, the deathly silence. The deathly silence is just wonderful. You're all in that much awe. All right. You lot are sweet, really. I know. But you know, this is always a chance to talk and ask stupid questions. Thunder. Whoa. Anyway, it's great to see you, Sierra. It is, it's been a while. So, let's think. So, in the spellcrafting thing, I was going through the fact that I'm really... Now, this... Oh, this is some admission. Especially as I've got, like, punting a book or whatever. But, you know, I have issues with words. It may not seem like it, but, you know, I'm slightly dyslexic and I'm not great with the writing. It takes a while to work. Thundersnow? That's a new one. Thunder. So the talk was about this next... I'm going to punt this new book and it's not even out yet or even written. I'm still trying to work on it. But my particular approach to using symbolism for magic as opposed to pure writing of spells. Mainly because, a wizard is never late. They arrive when they intend to, because someone's saying they're a bit late. Lord of the Rings, isn't it? I was going to say Merlin, but that wasn't that. It was Gandalf. Oh, dear. Yeah, I know. Gandalf. I really need to eat something. So where was I going? Oh, yes. Because I pretty much suck at poetry. And I've only written one or two sort of poetic kind of spells. And... they just don't seem to work for me. So the idea that I was going with the workshop and for this next booklet is on trying to work out ways to make it a bit easier. Because, you know, a lot of these books you may buy, or you even see some of these websites online that offer lots of interesting spells you can look up, they are quite intimidating. In regards to the, you know, the beautiful poetry that some of this... And when I say beautiful poetry, even some dirty limerick that someone can come up with as a part of a spell is quite astounding as far as I'm concerned. Trying to make something rhyme is just pure magic in itself as far as I'm concerned. I just cannot do it. So my particular view is making use of... predefined sort of template-y kind of approach of taking the time to work out something and then seeing gluing it together with other bits of text and just slotting in the bits that are required and rinse and repeat. Just keep repeating and trying new stuff and reusing anything where you can get inspiration, you know. Even if it's from contemporary fiction, I do not see a problem with using that as far as involving a spell. For example, some of my banishment techniques, I tend to use laughter or just say sod off to my goddess and sisters when I'm done with them. But, you know, I wouldn't have a problem with saying Hasta la vista, baby, from the Terminators film, to say as a means to banish. It's the connection you have here in your head and with how you translate that thought, that intent into action and into words. So if you're using contemporary fiction, then, you know, if that's what appeals to you and triggers that mind and mind action effect, then go for it. So that was pretty much the gist of Thursday. And as inevitably as most of my talks tend to end up going, is that I will tend to bring up the subject of chaos magic, because I tend to use a lot of symbolic approach, and when you start to move away from the words and go into a purely imagery approach, you start to encounter sigil work, and that tends to be where I go the most. Imagery is certainly a highly valuable form of magic as far as I'm concerned, because it doesn't rely on remembering swathes of text, which my rubbish memory goes, is not a good thing. Doesn't help if you get the lines out of sequence, because that can seriously damage the flow, and, you know, having to stumble over words. And in cases like this, where I've had a couple, I definitely do not want to be trying to recite some text because I need to cast a spell. Not that I, well, under the influence is probably a bad thing anyway, because things get a bit muddled. But, you know, if I was coming home like now, as I was from the pub, and I needed to cast some kind of protection, then trying to articulate the vocal aspect and trying to get the lines in my head to cast some kind of spell would probably be a bad thing. So for me, any kind of symbolic form is beneficial because I have images in my head. Do I have any sigils handy? Again, my journal is downstairs in my coat pocket, so I don't have anything handy. But, you know, I have imagery. Oh, well, there's one right there behind me. I'm just trying to... I'm pointing with my finger. Yep, there's one right here on the wall behind me. The Ankh-Unkh symbol. The Unkh hieroglyph. The... you know, like fever. The Unkh is one of the sigils that I probably use. I say sigil, but, you know, it's an Egyptian hieroglyph. It's a word, and it's a highly beneficial word. It's a highly life-empowering symbol. It is the origins of life. It's a powerful symbol. So I tend to have all these in my head, and should I need to cast them, I can just bring them forward and project outwards. And that requires very little effort, and certainly fulfills the crap memory that I have. And obviously it's a very quick thing to do. So that was the gist of Thursday. So that's 2 hours summarized in about 10 minutes. Oh, those poor guys who have sat through 2 hours of that. Anyway, I'm really starting to get hungry now for munchies. So shall we go any further, I wonder, or shall we just draw a line here before it gets too embarrassing? I'm starting to sober up now. So we've got quite a crowd. Is there, you know, you were all listening, and I mean you locked down here in Second Life. Oh, someone's typing. Yup, okay. Nods. Yes, you are all listening. Thank you! question. Oh, is this good Sunday evening entertainment for many of you? Certainly better than watching the TV sometimes. You know, technically about 8 minutes remaining. We could go over a little bit. I know some of you may will probably want to disappear. Oh, I'm sorry to drag you away from watching other stuff. You can always pause it. it's just militant bunch, you lot. Anyway, right. We can wrap up now. Or we could, go down another rabbit hole for a few minutes. Anyone got any particular places we want to go? If not, then... Ooh, typing. Who's typing? If not, then thank you for the... rabbit hole sounds... I know, the rabbit hole is always fun. In fact, I have... It's a secret. Well, I wouldn't say it's a secret. I have actually the Tim Burton Alice in Wonderland DVD I bought a couple of weeks ago to watch yet. And, you know, I do have... I'm not sure if I should be going on record of saying this. I know I've said this a lot of times to a lot of people, but, you know, this is actually being recorded, so I'm not sure if I want this on... But I'm going to do it anyway. I actually do have... and my wife does know about this. And I may need to point this out. I do have a thing for Helen Bonham Carter. So, that's why I've got this. To fulfil some... I'm not going to do anything nasty while watching this. Just don't worry about that. This is really bad. I'm actually saying all this. And it's going to come back. She is... Joy! I'm not even going to repeat that. Not that she'll be watching any of this, probably. She is actually crazy. But, you know, that's why I love her so much. And, in fact... Ooh, sync. Is that... There's our photo down there on the thingy. Anyway, Well, that's just filled in a couple of minutes. You guys, you've put up with a lot. Anyway, I think possibly because we are really pushing it a bit and I haven't prepared in the slightest for this one, we might actually just say our time has come. Anyway, I will wrap up. And of course, you know, a couple of minutes, you can always throw in something to take us back down the rabbit hole. I've got no problem with that. But, you know, I will just do a wrap-up by the time I finish this wrap-up. If someone's got something, we'll keep going. So anyway, thanks for coming in for this completely unusual, off-the-wall and slightly drunk one. You are always a great gang. You lot on Second Life. I'm pointing at the YouTube lot and saying Second Life. You lot, you lot on Second Life and you lot on the YouTube bunch. So, you know, anytime you've got any questions, always come back. My healing, Second Life healing circle is a week on Wednesday and I'll be back here in 2 weeks. You never know, I might actually be back to rerunning the series again, the visualization one. Or we may just run this again, and I might actually prepare. Who knows? We like the uncertainty of the way things are going. But I should be a little bit more sober. So, thank you, folks. It's always great, and you put up with a lot. Thank you for coming by. This may actually be on my... Yeah, I'm gonna probably regret doing this, but I think I will actually upload this one to YouTube. It seems like a good laugh. It fills in the bandwidth. Anyway, thank you guys. You are wonderful, and I will see you all again real soon. Nanite, I need to go and get some food now to try and sort myself out and sober up. Wassail. oh, what's fun? Oh, I'm glad that was. was fun. It was a little bit of a bit of an off the wall one. We tend to be a little bit more structured next time. Okay, I'm going to linger for a while. I hope I'm not driving you to drink. Although I have to admit, doing this slightly with a bit of alcohol does help. Normally, when I'm doing these, I do usually have a glass with me, just in case. Okay, there's something going on. Okay, I will probably need to... Okay, I might have to... Okay, yep, I do need to actually get some food because I'm not eating since lunchtime. So, on top of 3 pints of beer, it was probably not a good move. Oh, and I had 2 peanuts. That's all I had. So, right, okay, I am going to sign off. Thanks a lot for coming. You are always welcome. See you all again very soon. You guys just so put up with so much. Night. Oh dear. Oh dear, Syrah. Never mind. Right, I better be going now. Night, or see you all soon. Let's sign off. Oh dear. Well, that was fun. Let's stop the recording. The audio is sorted, and second life is off, and this is going off. Bye bye, YouTube land.